Hi, everybody. Welcome back to a little tea time. Got a little. That's my tea right there. This little mug is from a like a Christmas festival up in Lake George, New York. Good times, good times. Repping Potsdam today. Repping Potsdam. All right, today we're going to look at the Latin American revolutions. This video should be nice and tight and quick if you follow along. Get your global review book, if you would. It's this thing right here. And crack it open to page 65. When you get on to page 65, what you're going to find is, it says at the top, revolution and nationalism. Now, those two concepts really take hold of this time period, the early 1800s, all right, the early 19th century. So what I want to do is I want to go over some of this, and I want to teach you a little bit more about your review book. Like, you can see right there, I've written, you know, first three. For me, the first three names that you see in your review book at the beginning of any chapter are really important. So these first three are Toussaint L'Ouverture, Simon Bolivar, and José de San Martín. Those three are going to be the focus of what we're going to be discussing today. Alrighty then, if you can turn the page 66 at the top of the page where it says political revolutions in Latin America. As a result of the successes of the revolutions in the United States and France, regions under Spanish and French control in Latin America desired to be rid of foreign rule. Revolutionary ideas took hold and independence movements began to take shape. Now, for me, I am an active reader. So even when I get done with a paragraph like that, and you guys didn't see me grab my pen or anything, but I would go back through and I'd underline things like Spanish, French, United States, France, Latin America, revolutionary, all right, independence. I would underline some of those things because I just want to make sure that my brain connects to some of the vocabulary. Now, the region of Latin America primarily is Mexico south, all the way through the tip of South America. All right, so that's typically what we consider Latin America. Latin America has to do with the Latin languages of Spanish and French primarily, although, as you might know, Italy is as well a Latin language. Excuse me, Italian, not Italy. Italy's a country. You knew that. Thanks for catching me. All right, the Spanish Empire. I'm going to continue. During the 1500s, the Spanish Empire in the Americas stretched from California to South America and brought great wealth to the nation. In return, the Spanish brought their government, religion, economy, and culture to the Americas. I would underline a few of those words, particularly things like government, religion, economy, and culture. Now, government. Spain maintained strict control over its distant empire. The king ran the colony, colonial government through his representatives or viceroys who ruled the provinces. Religion. The Catholic Church was very important to the colonies. Church leaders helped run the government and worked to convert thousands of Native Americans to Christianity. Encomienda system. Spanish law allowed its colonies to trade only with Spain. Growing sugarcane on large plantations became an important business activity in the colonial empire. Because plantations needed so many workers, the Spanish created the encomienda system. A conquistador, under the system, was granted land along with permission to demand labor or tribute from Native Americans in the area. After many of the overworked Native Americans died, the Spanish brought enslaved Africans to do the work. If you want to research more about this system and the dangers of it and how horrible it was, you can look up anything about the colonization of Haiti. Now, social classes. A social structure developed that placed people in hierarchy. The Spanish-born people at the top of the class structure were known as peninsulares. They're from the peninsula. Spain is on a peninsula with Portugal. Creole was the name given to those European descent who were born in the colonies. Mestizos were people of mixed Native American and European descent, and mulatto was a term for those of mixed African and European descent. Now, there's some key words there that you might want to underline. Things like Creole, mestizo, and mulatto. Now, just to continue and finish this section, culture. Over time, the people in the colonies developed a new culture that combined European, Native American, and African traditions. These people spoke Spanish, but also used Native American and African words. The art, architecture, and daily life in the empire was influenced by all three of these cultures. Now, one of the cool things that your review book does is it has these sections, like preparing for the regents, which is a little box on the side of the page. And I always think to myself, after I've read a section, if I can answer those types of questions, then I'm probably okay. So I look at that question, it says, explain how the people of the Spanish colonial society were categorized into different social classes. Why might this structure lead to unrest? If I can think about that and I can answer it, I then write down the answer in my review book and I move along. If I can't figure that out immediately, I go back and do some more reading to see if maybe I missed something or if I just wasn't, you know, really in tune and engrossed. That's why I underline words, because those are the words I'll first look at before I really dive back in. Now, for the rest of this, I'm going to rely on your review book still, but I'm really going to just teach you a little bit about Latin American revolutions and the independence movements using three people's names. Toussaint Louverture, Simón Bolívar, and José de San Martín. So if you can look on page 67, I'm going to be talking a lot about the information that's in there, and I'm only going to read a little bit of it to you. So if you can go down and find the word Toussaint Louverture, it's in bold. It's halfway through the page. And I'm just going to read you a little bit about him. In 1791, a self-educated former slave named Toussaint Louverture led a revolt. Toussaint was familiar with the works of the Enlightenment thinkers and wanted to lead his people to liberty. Now, I'm going to circle the word liberty. Liberty is very important. I've emphasized that a lot lately. Liberty, liberty, liberty. That idea of freedom. So in that quest for liberty, Toussaint's very brilliant. What he's going to do is, Napoleon's running amok around Europe, he's really not hyper-focused on the colonies. And Haiti, although it was a big moneymaker, a lot of money coming out of Haiti in the sense of the sugar trade, Napoleon's going to send troops in 1802 just to kind of say, hey, can you keep the noise down a little bit? But those troops aren't going to be his best troops because he's more focused on his European campaigns. And yellow fever is going to strike, and it's going to take out many of those troops. And with the guerrilla warfare tactics and things like that, Napoleon's going to abandon the island, basically say, I can't handle this. I got too much else going on. And Toussaint's going to lead this rebellion successfully. When the island is abandoned, it says right in here, Haitians declare their independence in 1804. Napoleon then abandons the island. Haiti becomes a republic in 1820. And that's an important date for Haiti, and I'd circle that. Right, the next guy we got on this page is Simón Bolívar. It looks like Simón Bolívar. And then the country of Bolivia is named after him. Now, Simón Bolívar was a Creole. He was, like many Creoles, very frustrated in the structure. The fact that his parents were Peninsulares, like many other Creoles, they saw this almost like the American Revolution, where a lot of the people that revolted, their really recent family, either parents, grandparents, or great-grandparents, were from Europe. So he kind of saw this kindred relationship between the American Revolution and what he wanted to do. So Simón Bolívar even had dreams of having like a United States of Latin America or a United States of South America. So Simón Bolívar, great admirer of the Enlightenment, and it says it right in here, the well-educated Creoles were frustrated. They owned much of the land and mines, but were governed by the Peninsulares. All right, Bolívar was inspired by the American Revolution, and he wanted to fight Spanish rule, and he gets the nickname the Liberator. All right, now our last guy, and the last person we're really going to focus on today, is José de San Martín. All right, he's right at the bottom of page 67 in your review book. All right, and on 67, you'll see him right at the bottom of the page, and I'm just going to read a little bit of this to you. So as this rebellion starts to spark in Napoleon's weakness, the fact he took over Spain, put his brother on the throne. Remember, I mentioned to you, his brother was not a very good leader. So all of these colonies are going to take advantage of this point in history. And in 1810, I'm going to read them from the very middle of it, Bolivar started his long struggle against Spanish. Over the next 12 years, he led a series of military campaigns and won the independence for Venezuela. All right, Colombia, Ecuador, Peru, and Bolivia. He then joined forces with this guy, Jose de San Martin, who defeated the Spanish in Argentina and Chile. All right? Now, the interesting thing about Bolivar and San Martin's relationship is it was really a relationship of convenience. Neither man truly liked each other, and they were both very equally popular, though, in South America. Now, in the long run, although independence is always a good thing, more liberty the better. Latin America has struggled from that point to through today to have a lot of stability in the region. Part of it is meddling countries like the United States in some ways. Part of it is just the cultural mix. It hasn't always done well. It hasn't always worked well. Some things like natural disasters, I think about Haiti with earthquakes and things like that. Those things have really taken a toll. So they haven't had a lot of political stability. Now, one of the things about the Creoles, they're going to replace the Peninsulares in the structure, but it's not like they were any really better than the Peninsulares, all right? They were just homegrown, you know? So it's going to lead to some economic problems, their reliance on a cash crop economy, and things of that nature. So hope you enjoyed this little review on Latin American revolutions. To life, back to reality.